الو، السلام عليكم. الو،
وعليكم السلام.
How are you doing, guys? So let me, everyone can hear me?
Yes.
Yes, yes.
So I'm going to share my screen. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي امري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي. You can see my screen now.
اي واضح.
Yes, شيخ.
So we need to speak a little bit about the origin of electricity. How was this electricity discovered? Do you remember this experiment when you somehow rub or move a rod, a plastic rod, a glass rod through your hair, or use your comb, or you can touch this rod with wool or silk, then you bring it closer to some piece of paper, it will attract this piece of paper, right? Do you remember
yes.
the thingy?
Yes.
How come this take place? An explanation?
This is what they call static charge.
What's your name, Mahmoud? Mahmoud al-what?
Al-Hawashi.
Please, when you speak, just say your name first. Mahmoud al-Hawashi. Okay, Mahmoud. So.
Sure. Yes, this is what they call the static charge. So when we rub, for example, the road, the positive charge accumulate in the road, and the negative charge accumulating the paper, so therefore we have an attractive force.
This is correct to a great extent. So once you rub this rod in your hair or using some wool, yani suf or harir silk, once you rub this rod with silk or the wool, some of the electrons might migrate, move from your hair to the rod. So the rod will have more negative charge. So the rod will be negatively charged compared with this piece of paper. So the piece of paper will look like positive charge and the rod will look like negative charge. So you will have some attraction between the rod and the piece of paper. And it could be the other way around. If you rub this rod in your hair or silk, based on the material of the rod, it could be the rod, could be glass, could be plastic. Some of the electrons might move from the rod to your hair. So the rod will be positive charge, will have less negative charge. So the paper will be negative charge, piece of paper will be negative charge, and the rod will be positive charge. So it could be the other way around. If you rub the same, so you have two plastic rods, as you can see. If we rub them with wool, what's going to happen? So the two plastic rods has been rubbed with the same material. Do we have attraction or repulsion here?
Repulsion.
it will be repulsion. This is a second experiment. In the first experiment, in this part, there is no rubbing. So just two normal plastic rod, never have been rubbed, so no force. If we rub the same rod with the same material, they will be, both of them will have the same charge. Either both will be negative or both will be positive. So they will repel each other. And if we have two different rods, one plastic, one glass, and you rub them with one of them rubbed with wool, the other rubbed with silk, one of them will be negative, the other will be positive. So actually, these experiments are the origin of the electricity. This is what make scientists think about electricity, and we should have two different charges. You call it, say, Ahmed, Muhammad, two different charges. We call it negative and positive, and the negative charge is coming from electrons, as you know. So today, inshallah, we start chapter 4, and chapter 4 is about electrostatics. Please read the introduction in the book. So the meaning of electrostatics is, or electrostatic field, is a field produced by a static charge distribution. So we are assuming that the charges are at rest, staying with very low speed. Typical example of electrostatic field is electrostatic field produced in cathode ray tube. Did you hear about cathode ray tube? Did you see this before?
Yes,
in
TVs.
Huh?
They were used in old TVs to produce.
This is a oscilloscope screen and the older TVs. You know, the TV screen, actually, this is like your TV screen, the older screen. What's going to happen is that you need to produce some electrostatic field between two plates. You see these deflection coils? This deflection coil causes a ray of electrons to move either upward or downward. So what you see in your screen is mainly small pieces of light, and this light is moving left and right, up and down, using some deflection plates. So we have electrostatic field here between these two plates. This electrostatic field are responsible to deflect the beam. So there are many applications of electrostatics, actually, in power transmission, in X-ray machine, you know, X-ray medical imaging. The X-ray is based on electrostatic field. The lightning protection, you know, the lightning bark is some kind of electrostatics, because the discharge between cloud and the cloud, or cloud and earth, cause the lightning phenomena. And it is based on electrostatics, actually. Touchpad, capacitive keyboard. You know that your capacitive keyboard or touch screen is based on electrostatic field. So electrostatic does exist everywhere. To be able to calculate the electrostatic field, we are going to use two laws, two formulas in this chapter. One called Coulomb's law, which you know from before, and the other called Gauss law. Coulomb's law can be used to calculate the electrostatic field due to any charge distribution. So if you have some charge distributed over different surface, different shape, you still can use Coulomb's law. Gauss law will be easier to use. So what I'm saying is that Gauss law still can be used instead of Coulomb's law if you have a symmetrical charge distribution. We are going to see that in some problems, Coulomb's law will take longer time, but once you use Gauss law, it will be much easier, especially if the charge distribution is symmetrical. As you know from physics 102, I guess, if you have two different charges, both of them could be positive or negative, separated by some distance, the force between these two charges, based on some experimental work, the force must be directly proportional to the charges itself. So Q1 and Q2, the more Q1, the more Q2, the more force. And the bigger the distance between the charges, the more the distance, the less the charge, right? If the two charges are separated by bigger distance, you will have less force. So the force must take this formula. It should be some constant, because we have directly proportional relationship between the force Q1 and the Q2, and the inversely proportional to the square of the distance between the two charges. So the force is expected to be some constant k times q1, q2 over the square of the distance between them. And it should be directed along a vector. So the force is a vector. It has a magnitude and direction. The direction will be from the source charge to the destination charge. So this formula is a force on q2 due to q1. So q1 is affecting q2 some force. So the force will take the direction from q1 to q2. The unit vector here, this unit vector is from q1 to q2. So this force is on q2 due to q1. How can we get this constant k? They have done some experimental work to calculate the constant. Basically, the constant, this constant based on some experiment equal to 1 over 4 by epsilon 0 or epsilon naught. Epsilon 0 is defined as the permittivity of free space. Any idea what is the meaning of epsilon 0 or epsilon? What is the meaning of permittivity of any material? Someone else.
What is the meaning of medium?
Nader?
Yeah, charge is can move. I mean, the charge can move in this medium or not?
The charge can move. Actually, it is something related to the electric field and electric flux. Basically, the electric field is some effect. The electric field is produced by a source. This source is some gathering of charges. So some charges will produce electric field. This electric field will be proportional to something we call electric flux. So the electric flux is like cloud of electric field. The more the permittivity, the bigger the permittivity, the bigger the electric flux. Okay, the more the permittivity, the bigger the electric flux that can exist in some material. Yes, of course, it depends on the material itself, the medium itself. Actually, each material has different epsilon. It's like your name. So each one has different fingerprint. Each one has different fingerprint, right? Each material has different epsilon. Epsilon is electric characteristic of the material. We have two parameters. Let me finish. We have two parameters, epsilon and mu, permittivity and permeability. Permittivity is related to the electric flux. Permeability, which is permeability is related to the magnetic flux. So the more the permeability, the more the magnetic flux, the more the permittivity, the more the electric flux. And both of them, mu and epsilon, permeability and permittivity, are very characteristic of the material. Each material has different epsilon and different mu. It will be clear more when we study electric flux. Yes, someone want to speak?
Yes. Can we say that it's related to the to how much can the material holds or store the electric charge?
The electric energy, actually. It is an indication of how much electric energy can be stored in a certain medium. You know the capacitor? Did you hear about capacitor? And two, is the capacitor? What is the capacitor used to? For?
Storage the charge.
For holding the charge or given sometimes for it to charge.
Not exactly. A capacitor is a storage of electric energy. A capacitor is a storage of, at the end you need energy. At the end you need energy. So the capacitor is a storage of electric energy. The coil, the inductor, is a storage of magnetic energy, okay? And the both electric energy is based on epsilon. Actually, the more the epsilon, the more the electric energy that can be stored in capacitor. The more the permeability, mu, the more magnetic energy that can be stored in inductor. This is very clear, I would say, meaning. Guys, do you want to have, so I'm going to give you some, quizzes, tests. It could be, most likely the quizzes will be online. And also I'm going to give you this class question. So on this Thursday, we have CQ. CQ1 means the class question. It will be covering the first, the previous three lecture. You know this? You know this in the syllabus? I have updated the syllabus.
Yes.
So inshallah, as you can see in the syllabus, so I have to approach actually, to be honest with you. When I choose, you know, I'm not watching you while you are solving this question. And we need to be fair. So I like to give you a reasonable question. At the time, I like the time to be enough. But to do this, you need to help me with something. Yani. If you help me, yani, it will be more logic for me or to give you a reasonable question. So how many students here? Do you mind, guys, to use camera during solving this question? So the camera will show your face and your computer monitor. Anyone here mind this? Because this way it will be more intuitive for me to give you a reasonable question.
You mean a separate camera?
Yes, you can use camera during solving all the exams and the question.
No, the camera, I mean like a separate device or the camera on the computer.
Whatever, itself. In Zoom, I need to see your face. Now you can see my face, right?
Yes.
You can see, I need to see your face and your computer monitor at the same time. So maybe you can place the camera somewhere that shows the computer monitor and your face. Do you mind doing this?
During the exams?
During all exams, any exam.
Yes.
And the question will be solved.
Yes, that's okay.
Doctor, what do you mean
be solved by blackboard?
By monitoring the screen.
Yani, you will place the camera somehow like this.
What if the camera is built in the
camera? Laptop? You can use your phone camera. You can buy a camera like this camera, like the camera I'm using. Yani, something like this. Now you can see my face and my computer monitor, right?
Yes.
So something like this. So I can make sure that you guys are, you know what you are doing now as teacher. We don't know what you are doing, to be honest, So there is some kind of agreement that we will give you a question. The time is hardly enough to solve the question. You will not have time to speak with anyone, to look at anything, if we give you this type of exam. I don't like to do it this way. I want to give you a reasonable time. I want to give you a question like the same when you are in class. Yes.
دكتور في الصيف كانوا يستخدمون معنا براوزر خاص اسمه
it's no longer available. It was like a trial test. We don't have license. It's we can't use it anymore. I asked this people about it, the education or the dad. They said they don't have license anymore. We can't use this private browser. How many students we have here? We need to move on. So everyone is okay by using this camera or it is hard for you? Anyone have camera, yes, separate camera? You can buy it maybe 30 riyal or.
Doctor.
How many? Yes.
For me, I'm okay with that, but I'm not sure if I'm able to.
Anyone has problem using camera?
No, doctor.
For me, I use my built-in camera with my laptop. Is it okay?
I can just show my face, but it's going to be difficult to monitor both my face and the laptop screen at the same time.
Okay. We can, if you can't show the monitor at the same time, we can display your face.
Doctor, I have a question.
All of you are using laptop, am I right? So using the laptop camera is not tough.
Yes.
Anyone using the phone now? Yes. Anyone is working on the phone now?
Yes, me.
And you can see the screen, you have camera in your phone as well.
Yeah, okay. I have camera in my phone and I have camera on my laptop. I can use my laptop also.
Okay, let's make it easy. So just to show your face, and please, yani, no need to, yani, to do anything illegal, because I will know. Yani, if you guys do something wrong, I trust you. I trust you like my brothers. But if you do something wrong, I will know. And if I know it, I will give tougher exam afterward.
Doctor,
okay, just to be clear, yani, with you.
I have a suggestion.
Okay, quickly, we are wasting time.
If you can share the paper that we solving, is that okay with you?
What paper?
In quiz or the paper that we are solving the exams. I mean, the quizzes, exercises, anything.
Share. So you mean after the exam, I choose a question?
Yeah, we can send you the papers that we are solving the
handwriting. Yani, actually, what I have in mind is to give you MCQ in Blackboard.
Yes, it's better. The handwriting
there are two advantages of this. There are two advantages in Blackboard. You will know the grade right away after half an hour, and also there is no yani negotiation. If it is handwritten, some people are easy grade. Maybe I'm easy grader. Maybe another teacher is tough grader. So MCQ is black and white. There is no negotiation, wrong or false.
Okay, doctor, but if it's MCQ in the Blackboard, we can go back and forward for in the questions. For example, I can solve question one, then I jump.
I have two options for this. Either maybe I don't give you a chance to go back, or I give you the chance.
Actually, you can show them
all. I don't know, some guys.
We need to move. Sorry, I will think
about
it.
It's a hard question. We can skip it and solve the easy one relatively.
Yes, I understand.
Then go back to the hard one.
Okay, guys. I will help you. I will try to do this, and I will see the consequences. But trust me, yani. Don't think that your colleague is solving it right. Yeah, and if you choose number A and your colleague choose number B, don't think he is right. Most likely he might be wrong, and you are the right one. So don't, yani, you are mature, yani. I know it's difficult, but you are mature people. So last year I asked my student to write oath. Yeah, oath means أقسم بالله العظيم. But it's like, and I don't like you to write this.
Doctor, in 400 course, we use the camera of laptop and open the mic. So in this case, you can monitor
This is also a good idea. So you turn on the mic and
camera.
And also most likely the exam question will be different. So I will change a number. So it might be same question but different number. So it will be different answer. So be careful, yeah.
I think settling on the mic is a bad idea because a lot of people talk when they solve questions. So it's
maybe. Then, yani,
including me, I talk when I solve questions. Yeah. So. Sometimes hard to keep
mute your speaker.
Doctor, نقدر نستخدم
mute your speaker in your laptop so you don't hear anyone.
Doctor, if you have any suggestions, can we send it by email?
Just yes, please send me. Yes, we are wasting time. If you have suggestion to have fair exam, send me so I can help you to give you a reasonable exam. Yeah, I'm doing my best to give you a reasonable exam. This is the reason I'm raising all this issue. So let's go back. So the force, as I have said, the force on Q2 due to Q1 will be directed along the unit vector 1 to 2. So as you can see, the unit vector going from 1 to 2, this is the force from Q1 on Q2. The constant K has been found to be 1 over 4 by epsilon naught. Epsilon 0 is the permittivity, which is proportion to the electric flux or electric energy. And it equal to 8. This is epsilon 0 of free space. Free space. This means if you have different material like wood, like glass, plastic, you will have different epsilon. What is the unit of K? So epsilon zero has unit farad per meter.
Unitless.
No, not unitless. It's 1 over epsilon, and epsilon is farad per meter. So K will
be... So meter per farad?
Meter per farad, yes. Meter per farad. The reciprocal reversal of epsilon. As you know, if the two charge has the same sign, it will be a repulsion. If different sign will be, you know this, it will be an attraction. You know this. So we have 2-point charge. Quick example, we have Q1 and Q2. Q1 is located at some point. Q2 is located at another point. We can think, by the way, I have found that the third edition is somehow similar to the sixth edition. So everyone now has a PDF of the third edition. It's available online. Yes, you can download it online. So please read the book. Read the book third edition until you get this fourth edition from somewhere. Yani, anyone here has a sixth edition hard copy?
Yes,
anyone got the hard copy?
Yes, I do.
You can get it from the previous student. If you know a senior student who finished this course, you can get the book from him. So we have Q1 and Q2. Q1 is located at some vector R1. Q2 is at R2. So how can we find the unit vector from Q1 to Q2? Now we know R1 and R2, okay? How can we find the vector from Q1 to Q2?
We can use...
It will be like subtraction. It will be subtraction R2 minus R1 or R1 minus R2. So basically, the unit vector here from... Now we need to find the force on Q2. Force on Q2 will be F12. So we need to find the vector 1, 2. 1, 2 means... Let me close this thingy. The vector will be R12. R12 means X2 minus X1. 1, 2, X2 minus X1. So X2 is 2, so 2 minus minus 3 will be 5. So this is the unit vector. It will be R2 minus R1, like subtraction. Then you calculate the force. This is the force from Q1 on Q2. What about the force on Q1 due to Q2? Should we repeat all the calculation again?
No,
plus the negative sign. Same magnitude, yeah, same magnitude by different opposite direction. So it will be negative F21 force of, on Q1 equal to negative force on Q2. What about if you have many charges? So you have Q1, Q2, Q3, Qn, large number of charges, and all these charges are affecting a single charge Q. So Q is receiving some force or affected by some force from all other charges. How can we find the total force on Q?
Linear operation, just summation.
It's superposition. If you're about superposition, it's linear summation. So the total force F1, the summation of Fi. Fi means F1 plus F2 plus F3. So it would be summation Qi over times Q. Qi could be Q1, Q2, Q3 times Q over the square of the distance times unit vector. Remember, the unit vector here is directed from the source charge to the destination, to the affected charge. So the source is Q1. The destination or the affected is Q. So the unit vector will be from the source to the affected charge. Tamam, shabab, clear? Don't clear, yes. Make sure you understand how to find the unit vector. It's always from the source to the destination or to the affected charge. Okay, now we speak about the electric field or static electric field. What is the meaning of electric field? Any idea? What is electric field?
It is like the area of affection for the charge. So every charge has area of affection. The area where the charge...
Yeah, to some extent, it's what you are saying makes sense. It is the electric field is an effect, some effect. And this effect must come from a source, right? And if you have any effect, any phenomena, it should have a source. The source of the electric field is electric charge. So the source of the electric field is electric charge. And if the electric charge are assumed to be at rest, so the electric field will be static electric field. So the static electric field are produced by some distribution of electric charge that are assumed to be at rest. Say you have queue. You see this queue? This queue is fixed in location. And you have another QT. QT could be anywhere. QT is a test charge. The charge that is going to be affected by some electric field produced by Q. So the electric field like a cloud of effect due to some source. The source here is the big Q, as you can see. And we need to find the force due to Q at QT. The force, as we know, will be Q times QT times the unit vector directed from the source to the destination. So the unit vector will be in this direction, right? So it will be Q times QT over 4 by epsilon 0 R square. It is a force per unit. So now, if we take the force F over the tested charge QT, this will give me the source charge big Q over 4 by epsilon naught R square. This quantity on the left-hand side is called electric field because it is a force per electric charge. And this electric field will be proportional to the source charge. This electric field will be proportional to the source charge and inversely proportional to the square of the distance and directed along AR. Do you see the test charge here? Do you see any QT here?
No.
So QT doesn't affect the test charge. QT, you see QT here? Has no effect on the electric field. The electric field is produced by the source charge and based on the distance. So the electric field has no relation with the test charge. Test charge is just an indication. So the electric field at this point equal to Q over 4 by epsilon 0 R square and directed from Q from the source charge to the point that is affected. So the unit is force per charge in Newton per coulomb or volt per meter. Any question, guys, about the meaning of the electric field? Any question? So now, any question? We have a charge Q at the origin. You see this charge at the origin? We need to find the electric field at a point B here in terms of Cartesian and the spherical coordinate. So we need to solve the problem twice. Once in Cartesian coordinate, so the unit vector will be AX, AY, AZ. And another time we find the electric field in spherical coordinate. Spherical coordinate means in spherical unit vector, AR, A theta, A phi. As you know, the electric field is a vector. And the electric field takes the direction of the force produced by from the source of charge at some tested charge. Yani the electric field has the same direction of the force because F over Q is the electric field. So in Cartesian, we need to find the electric field. So we need to find the distance from the source of charge to any point, and this point is located at XYZ. So the vector is XYZ, right? This is a vector from the origin to any point defined by XYZ. Any point in free space. Because Q at the origin, so it is X minus zero. If Q is located at another place, it will be X minus location of Q. Okay, Shabab? So this is a vector R from the source of charge to any point in Cartesian coordinate. So the electric field will be Q over 4 by epsilon R square times the unit vector. The unit vector is defined as the vector R over square root of X square plus Y square plus Z square times R. It will be this quantity power 3/2. So this electric field in Cartesian coordinate at any point in free space. Any question here, guys? Aiswael? Now we need...
That's clear.
Now we need to repeat and define the electric field based on spherical coordinate. Spherical coordinate means it should be based on the unit vector AR, A theta, A phi. You remember the spherical coordinate?
Yes.
So just a quick, spherical coordinate is based on three unit vector. You see the unit vector AR, E theta, E phi? AR is directed from the origin to the location of the point, this AR. E theta is in the direction of increasing theta. E theta is normal to AR. E phi is a unit vector perpendicular to the plane of AR and E theta. تمام يا شباب؟ So this is a three unit vector. يعني if I'm assuming that this point is in YZ plane, if the point, this point in YZ plane, what is the direction AFI? If the point in XY plane, what should be the direction AFI?
Z plane?
Yes. And what I'm seeing is so this is X, Y, Z. So in spherical coordinate, if you have a point here, B, this point will tell us the information about the unit vector. So the unit vector, this is the unit vector AR. How do I know it is the unit vector AR? This is the distance R, right? So this is distance R. So in the direction of increasing R, you will find the direction AR. The direction AR is the direction of increasing R. And this is angle theta, is angle theta. And the angle phi is defined by the projection of this line in XY plane. So basically this is angle phi. So where is the direction of E theta? It is here, in the direction of increasing theta. Because if theta increases, if theta become bigger, the point B will move this way, right?
Yes.
So the direction of theta in the direction of increasing theta. Where is the direction of A phi? It will be the third unit vector that is right angle with both AR and E theta. And A phi, it should be in this direction, not the other direction. Because this is based on this is called the right hand system. A phi must be in this direction, not the other direction. So based on this information, if the point B is located in YZ plane, if the point B in YZ plane, where should be the direction A phi? Inside the page, inside the page, right? Because A phi will be in the direction of increasing phi. If the point B is in YZ plane, if the point B located in YZ plane, what is the value of phi? 90 degree. You need, I think it's not clear for you. We will review this in the lab. We'll explain this in the lab in much details, yeah. Now we need to find the electric field due to a charge located here. So charge located at the origin. We need to find the electric field at any point B in spherical coordinate. What should be the direction of the electric field?
R,
just R, very easy. Yeah, this is what makes it easy. That at any point along this line, yani, what I'm saying is, at any point, yani, this is the XYZ, okay? So you have a certain charge here at the origin Q. And this charge is affecting this point by some electric field. The electric field is in this direction, right? Which is the direction of AR. It's just simple R. That's it. So what should be the answer here? What should be the electric field in spherical coordinate?
R itself.
That's it. Electric field Q over 4 by epsilon 0 R squared AR. The simple equation. Because AR is already defined in spherical coordinate. In the same way we define the electric field. You don't need to do anything. Just this electric field based on spherical coordinate. تمام. But in Cartesian, you need to calculate the distance R. by square root of x square y square z square. In spherical, it is ready. R, the coordinate R is already the distance. Yeah, the point here is defined by R theta phi. R is the distance from the origin to the point, which is the distance of the electric field. If the point, if you have a charge at x prime, y prime, z prime, yeah, a charge here at x, x dash, y dash, z dash. And we need to find the electric field at x, y, z. So the charge now, not at the origin, at somewhere else. And we need to find the electric field at x, y, z. How can we find the electric field?
As we find the distance vector by subtraction.
Exactly. The distance will be r minus r prime, because this r prime, r dash, and this r. So this vector is r minus r prime. So the electric field will be, again, yani symbol will be, first you need to find the distance, r minus r prime. Because the vector must be from q to this point, from the source to the test point. This is the direction of electric field. So it will be, regardless of the, sign of the charge. Charge could be positive or negative. We don't care, but the direction must be from the source to the test point. So it will be x minus x prime, y minus y prime, z minus z prime, because this r minus r prime. And then you substitute in the formula of the electric field. What about, any question guys, ISOL? ISOL? What about if we have a large number of points? So we have Q1, Q2, Q3, up to Qn, and we need to find the electric field due to all these charges. How can we find the electric field due to many charges? Again, superposition, summation. To be the electric field of charge number one, plus electric field charge number two, plus electric field of, and so on. So it will be E1 minus plus E2 minus E3. But remember, what is the direction of E1? What is the direction of E2? What is the direction of E3? Direction is very important, guys. So the direction is always from the source to the test point, or we call it observation point. Observation point, the point where you calculate the electric field. So assuming you have Q1 many charges located at some point B1, B2, Bn, so the total electric field will be of this format. Any question, guys? By the way, the formula sheet in Blackboard can be used in all exams, all questions. So there are many equations there. You don't need to memorize the equation in the formula sheet. تمام يا شباب? The formula sheet in Blackboard can be used in all exams and all questions. So it will be easy for you because it has a big number of equations. Total electric field will be Qm. Qm could be Q1, Q2 times the unit vector from each source of charge to the test point over the distance squared from each source of charge to the test point. Simple example, consider a point charge Q1 located at B1 and another charge Q2 located at B2. Find the electric field intensity at another point 4, 2, 3. So we have two electric charge, both positive, located at different places. And we need to find the electric field at a third place. So just use this formula. So summation M1 to 2, because we have two charges only, 1 to 2. Qm will be Q1 or Q2, x minus xm prime. X is the point location. So x here is 4. Okay, guys? X here is 4. Xm could be this point or the other point. Tamam? Y here is 2. Ym is this point or this point. And so on, just the direct substitution, yani. It should be easy for you to do it. And the answer will be as a vector, this electric field vertible meter. Okay, in Cartesian coordinate. Tamam, shabab, this lecture number 4. Guys, when you go home, don't open the lecture in front of your screen and just read the problem. If you keep reading this problem 100 times, it is useless. What you should do?
Practice.
So you should read the solution quickly if you like, hide the solution and handwrite the solution. Use your hand and pencil to write. Don't do like what I'm doing in classes, reading the solution. Of course, I'm reading the solution because it's easy, yani, stuff you took before. But when we have tough problem, I will solve it by hand. I will try to solve it by hand. But don't read the solution like what I'm doing. You have to write hand. Fahmin? لازم تحل بإيدك. Okay. Of course, you need to solve also as much problem as you can. Now, what we have done is that we have calculated the electric field due to point charge. Point charge means the charge is very small compared to the medium on which the charge exists. يعني, do you know the pinhead? Pinhead, the boost صغير. The pinhead might be much bigger than some charges located on the pinhead. So if we have some electric charge located at the pinhead, it's called the point charge. And what we are doing is based on point charge. Point charge means the charge take very small place compared with the medium on which the charge exists. Now, how can we find the electric field due to continuous charge distribution? So if we have some charge distribution could be a line, wire, filament, line, could be a surface. Surface could be a surface of a sphere, cylinder, any surface. Could be a volume. Yeah, the charge can be distributed over a line, surface, or a volume. In all three cases, the charge could be uniform and could be non-uniform. What's the difference between uniform charge distribution and the non-uniform charge distribution?
Equal distributed and
yes, for uniform, the charge is independent of position. So the charge is the same everywhere. And if you have a wire carrying some charges, the charge is the same at every place on the wire. We call it uniform distribution. If the charge has different value based on the position, we call it non-uniform distribution. فاهمين؟ يعني لو, if we have a surface like this, and you have the same charge everywhere on the surface. This uniform distribution, if you have the same charge everywhere. If you have more charges here, less charges in another place. So more charges in some place, less in another place, is called non-uniform. So we could have both, yani we could be dealing with both. So we need to understand whether we have uniform or non-uniform. If it is uniform, solution will be easier. Now we start by the line charge. The line charge we define a line charge by the charge distribution, charge per unit length. So see this like snake, this like wire, some bent wire, curved wire. This wire carries some charge. We define the wire by the charge density or charge per unit length. The charge per unit length is defined as the limit of delta Q over delta L when delta L is very small. So the charge per unit length, when we consider this length to be very small. If the charge distribution, if rho L is constant, we call it uniform. If rho L, if the charge distribution is function of position, so rho L is say 2x plus 2y. 2x plus 2y, it's based on position. So it's non-uniform. And rho L could be uniform if it is constant, fixed number, or could be non-uniform if it is function of position. In this case, if we have, how can we calculate the electric field due to this snake-like wire? You see this wire from A to B? How can we find the electric field from the whole wire?
Line integral.
We need to divide the wire into small pieces. You know, if you have a big problem, to solve a big problem in your life, you need to try to divide it in small problems and solve each small problem alone. This will be easier than solving big problem. And always try to look at the origin of the problem, from where you have this problem. This in general, yeah. So we need to divide the wire into small pieces. هنقطع الوير into small pieces. And then we take each small piece as a point charge. And to calculate the field due to this small piece. then calculate the field or add the field from all the small pieces to find the total electric field. This is integration. Integration is a summation, right? Finite integration is the area under the curve, as you know from math something. So the electric field will be the integration of the unit charge times dl. Unit charge times dl, this is indication of the charge in a small piece of the wire. Small piece of the wire will carry rho ldl. Look at this equation. What is delta q here? What is delta q? Rho times dl delta l. The charge due to small piece. So, and we need to find r dash. R dash is, look here. R dash is the location of delta l. So delta l is located at some r dash. And the vector r is the location of point B. So by calculating r minus r dash, as if it is your point charge. And we are dealing with this small piece as if it is point charge. Tamam, shabab? Time is done. Am I speaking so loud? Should I lower my voice?
No, it's good.
Because I look like scaring you by my voice. But I'm a little bit enthusiastic. So I have shared with you something called the Saraha. Saraha, you write anything to me. Yeah, and you know this website? You can write anything you like here. Where is it? I send you some link where you can send any message to me. Send anything you want to say about my teaching, my attitude, but try to be objective. So if you have a problem, tell me some solution to this problem. Also, we can have a class representative, guys. If you have 2 minutes, can you choose class representative? Two students to act as a class representative. موصل الفصل. So you choose 2 students, they will meet with me every 3 weeks to discuss any problem you have in the course. Okay, معايا؟ عايزكم تختاروا, you choose 2 students to act as class representative, ممثل الفصل. They will be like, if you have problem, just tell them. Maybe you are embarrassed to tell me. Tell them if you have some problem and they will meet with me and discuss this problem. So please take 2 minutes. I will finish, I will leave the meeting. And you choose 2 students and tell me the names of these 2 students. Tamam? Had I ask haga? Anyone, you be anything? Anyone, you be aya haga?
Thank you.
Okay, so choose a class representative, please. We have lab today for those having lab at 2 p.m. I will leave the meeting and you speak together, please, and choose this class representative. I'm looking how can I leave this meeting. So Mahmoud will be will.